So then the next welding process, quickly move on, is the induction welding. So induction welding is commonly also used to achieve very high joint efficiency, okay. So generally, I mean induction welding, how do you use that? Because induction welding, I mean you are using polymers, they are not conductive, right? So how do you use the induction principle? So we add a small implant, so conductive material, generally polymers doped with metal particles or some fibers of alloys, okay. So the implants are placed inside the joints to be made, and then you apply electrical induction, electromagnetic induction process. So the implants heats up and melts and solidifies. During this process, the interface also melts, and subsequently you do an upsetting, okay. So that is why it is also known as an electromagnetic welding or EMA welding. So generally we use in a very high frequency AC current, alternating current, to excite the implant which you place at the joint. So without implants it is not possible to do that, because you cannot heat up a polymer using induction principle, okay, unless it is a conducting polymer, okay. So the generally implants are made of this composite of polymer and metal, okay. The polymer is the similar polymer what you want to weld, and then you add some conductive metal particles, or most commonly you know you can also add the graphite fibers, okay. So to make it conductive, and the implants heats up and melts, and during this process the interface also is molten from the heat actually the implant generates, okay. So heat is generated by the induction principle. So this is the induction welding process. You first place an implant, right, and you have work coil, and these two surfaces to be joined. Okay, so this is top and this is bottom, the implant is placed, and the induction coil sends the electromagnetic waves, and during this process the implant heats up, and then you apply a downward force, and then implant melts and joins the interface. Yeah, subsequently the implant can be solidified. Is clear? Induction welding process. So these are the common components we use, cartridges, okay, water cans. So water cans, you know, nowadays they are all used in injection molding. So these lamps, for example, lamp holders, and we can also use it to, you know, join a polymer on top onto a metal as well, okay. So in this case you do not need implant, it's metal heats up and then polymer can be molten, and then apply pressure, and then they can be joined, right. So it commonly used for household applications, plastic caps to plastic bottles, even solar panels can be welded. So you can use it for large irregular parts that are injection molded and then blow mounted. So blow mounting is like, you know, this blow mounting, right. So you can heat up the induction and the metal part, and then polymer can be blown into that. Good. Again, what are the advantages, disadvantages? And you'll have to look at, you'll have to understand the advantages, then only you can select the process, right. So objective of this course is to make you select a welding process for an application. Unless you know advantage or disadvantage, you can't decide on what process I'll have to go. I can use a hot plate also, but it's not possible always use to hot plate, okay. So induction melting, so if you want to make a pressure tight joint, and this is the best process, okay. So we can also use it for large the bond lines up to 6 meters. You can also use it for 3-dimensional parts, because induction heating, electromagnetic waves can be used, okay. So the implants composition can be modified to get a very good structural strength, okay. So in a simple hot plate, the interface may not be good, it has good mechanical properties, but here you can add extra strengthening material. The implant itself can increase the strength of the joint, and the implant can be selected such a way that if you are joining two dissimilar polymers, the implant material can be selected which is actually compatible with both polymers, okay. So and you can heat up exactly what you where you want, that is also another advantage, okay. Very precisely we can control, and it can be made it very fast production cycle. And here is the disadvantage is extra material you add in implant, the weight increases, okay. So that is a bigger disadvantage in this process. Okay, so then you need to place the implant. That itself is a work. Okay, yeah. So sometimes implant affect the mechanical properties if you don't choose properly. So that's again a disadvantage. Good. So material. So almost all thermoplastic materials, crystalline, amorphous, and the high performance, difficult to join. They all can be welded using induction welding. Okay, so dissimilar material, thermoplastic material containing glass, talc, minerals, wood, they all can be welded. The implant material generally it's very electromagnetic material. Generally we use an metallic mesh, ferromagnetic micro mesh. We can place it inside the implant. Right? It's clear. So joint designs, again you can place the implant and then press it. Once the moment the implant melts and then you can squeeze it, make a joint, right? So this is before, so simple flat to flat and then flat to groove and then tongue and groove, which I showed you in previous slide, and then shear and the step, all of them can be joined. Right, it's clear? Good. So instead of using induction, we can also use resistance current. Okay, the same principle is the same. Okay, in a resistance implant welding, you are heating up the implant by resistance heating. Okay, so in the advantage of this process is in the implant may not be doped with the ferromagnetic material. Okay, so what you need is you use an induction coil, and you place the implant on top of the coil, melt the implant, and subsequently you can take the induction wire out. See, for example, in this case, the insulator, and this is the part to be joined. The is kept between the heating element, okay, and then apply pressure, right, and then so you make a joint. Subsequently, the heating element, the fibers would remain the same at that joint, right. So the and this process bit complex. Because the heating element, it has to be selected such a way that it acts as a fiber reinforced plastics. Okay, so subsequently, you have to use a consumable. The fiber itself becomes a consumable. Good. So we'll move on to the other process, and subsequently.
All these do not alter the microstructure of the polymer.
Generally, thermoplastic polymers, you can melt it, that's what I said in the first class, first slide. So these welding processes are only used for thermoplastics, which can be heated up a number of cycle times. Okay, thermosetting polymers you can't use, you can't weld. Okay, only adhesive, that's what we'll see in the subsequent slides. But when you are using a thermoplastics, it can be heated up and molten any number of time. Okay, so one thing is the curing time or cooling or heating time should be controlled properly. Okay, so otherwise thermoplastics, I mean, they are all reversible material, right? They don't really change the metal properties. You can heat up and cool down any number of time. Then the ultrasonic welding, so it's also very widely used for thermoplastics, and the principle is exactly same as we saw in ultrasonic welding of metals. Okay, so we use very high frequency ultrasounds from 25 to 40 hertz to produce the vibrations, low amplitude vibrations, 1 to 25 micron. Okay, so the vibration heats at the interface, right, and the process can be extremely fast, about very tiny amount, 1 second, less than a second. And the principle is same. So you have a downward force. You send an ultrasonic transducers at the interface. The interface vibrates in a very low amplitude, and you don't see less than 25 micron. And doing this process, you generate heat by friction. Subsequently, you apply a downward force to make a joint. Right? It's clear. And as the principle, if you look at it, the same as you do it in a metal ultrasonic welding. So the interface to be welded. Okay. So this is an ultrasonic transducer, and then a waveguide. And this is the base plate. Okay, so the welding fixes, and then the molded parts and the welding horn, and then you apply an ultrasonic vibrations at the interface, and then you make a joint. So this is the top and this is the bottom plate, and the bottom fixture is fixed, and then the top one is mounted to the ultrasonic transducer waveguide, and then you vibrate the top plate with the bottom plate. Bottom plate is fixed, you generate heat, and upon generating sufficient temperature at the interface, you apply downward force, and that force would make a joint. Yes, it's clear. It's the same as we use it for ultrasonic welding of metals. So one of the so you don't need ultrasonic frequency as high as the metals. Here we can use the same frequency, but the welding time can be extremely short. Okay, good. So material compatibility, I just gave this slide for your reference. And ultrasonic welding can be used for almost all the thermostatic polymers. You see the diagonal line. Okay, so the ultrasonic welding is commonly used for thermostatic polymers. Almost all of them, you can use them. Okay, and some of the polymers I listed, these are all commonly used engineering polymers. You can refer it whenever you want. Good. So we'll move on to the applications, and then we'll look at the adhesive bonding. So ultrasonic welding. So what are the applications? Automotive applications. The majority of parts, plastic parts used in automotive applications, they are all ultrasonic welded. And lamps, dashboards, buttons, switches, fuel filters, fluid vessels, seat belt locks. Okay, the electronic key fobs, lamp assemblies, air ducts, and I just collected from my memory. So whenever I go for automotive industry, I look at all the welding processes. So these are all the parts. Generally, they are ultrasonic welded. Okay, and ultrasonic welding also used for the electronic applications. Okay, we also use the plastics in the computers, mobile phones. Okay, and hard drive. Okay, so hard drive casings, polymers, insulators, they are all ultrasonic welded. For medical applications, I have just got it from a handbook. Filters, catheters, garments, masks. Okay, so even packaging. Okay, so packaging, blister packs, pouches, tubes, containers. Okay, so they are all welded using ultrasonic welding. Right, so the advantage of this process is high volumes. For example, the pouches, you'll have to make close to a million a day, isn't it? So you'll have to produce it as soon as possible. The hot plate and all extremely complex, so you need some time. The ultrasonic welding, the welding time is less than a second in most of the cases. Okay, so rapid production is possible using ultrasonic welding for polymers. Good. So these are some of the components commonly used. Coffee pot, right? So thermos coffee pot. The material is polystyrene. So tong with groove joint. What you see over here. So this is electronic switch by stacking joint, and reflector for your bicycle. So bicycle reflector at the back. You have that. So those are all ultrasonic joints. So lens assembly. So medical bottle. Okay, diaphragm, fuel filter for automotive fuel filter. Okay, and electrical junction box. Okay, so junction box, I don't know whether you have, no, it's all concealed over there. Okay, so those are all done with an ultrasonic welding. So I think it also has some material, isn't it? Lexan, and there are plenty of polymers that are used in engineering applications, right? Good. And then similar to ultrasonic welding, you can also reduce the frequency, increase the amplitude. Okay, so ultrasonic vibrations, the amplitude are very tiny, not even more than 20 micron, 25 micron. But you can also increase vibrations to higher amplitude, reducing the frequency. Okay, you will still generate heat. Okay, so these kind of the large amplitude vibrations can be applicable if you want to weld a larger cross section or bigger parts. Okay, The principle is the same. The friction at the interface produces the heat, subsequently melts, and then you apply pressure, the molten material flows. You need larger time than the ultrasonic welding because the amplitude of vibration is larger, okay. And in this case, the parts to be welded should have some symmetry, okay. So, otherwise you can't join these two process parts. And so, you can do it in linear or you can also do in orbital. So, linear vibrations, so you can do it like this or you can also do in orbital vibrations. The whip blade I showed you the during friction stir welding, so that is vibration welding, is not it? So, you have an vertical or linear vibrations. So, this is a schematic. So, this is a container to be welded, okay. So, in a 3-dimensional object. So, the bottom part is fixed within fixtures and the top is mounted with an electromagnetic vibration unit with a spring attached, and this part goes in there and then vibrates in this case linearly on top, and then subsequent after upon heating the interface, then you can also apply a downward force, and then and the two parts can be joined, right, it's clear, good. Again, advantages, so I always this is very important, right, so to select a welding process. So, what are the advantages of vibration welding? Reasonably short welding time, energy efficient, and you can use it for larger parts, and surface preparation you do not need to worry about it because anyway it is going to be smoothened, okay. You do not need an extra implant like in resistant implant or induction implant welding, okay. And in a transparent material, weld is clear, optic clear, that is also very important, okay. So, if you have a weld seam which is opaque and if you are making in a container, it should be transparent, then your product appearance goes down, okay. But it has an high investment cost because you need to develop the fixes and then transducers, the clamping mechanism, okay. So, the larger parts very difficult to lock. So, this process is also very dirty because it produces a lot of tiny particles during vibrations and it becomes very noisy as well. So, 90 dB, and this is very noisy, extremely noisy. So, what is the noise level of our sarang rock show? There was a lot of debate about the noise level of our sarang rock show. Last year we measured during 2018 January, I mean this January, it is 90 to 120 dB, okay. So, it is very loud. So, the sound generation it can be very noisy. I personally I do not like the surface rubs, I mean I feel goosebumps. Okay, so, it can be I can't stare it the surface even a friction welding and then I do not look at it, otherwise I always have goosebumps somehow, I do not know, and it can also be very noisy, extremely noisy, okay, good. So, what are the applications of this? So, the high volumes, okay, so mainly appliance industry, like for example, the water bottles, okay. The washers, dishwasher pumps, okay, soap dispenser, dishwasher spray arms, for example, okay. So, and automotive application also very widely used, okay. Either vibration welding or ultrasonic welding, instrument panels, components, air conditioning, heater ducts, vacuum reservoirs, okay. So, airflow sensors, etc. Good. So, joint designs, the symmetry should be maintained. So, okay, otherwise heat dissipation can be very tricky in vibration welding.